We're so grateful and thankful for the opportunity to come to you again by way of YouTube at Greater Second LR. It's another day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. We're just grateful for this time with you each week. And as we make ready to get started, would you bow with me in a word of prayer? Most gracious and almighty God, we humbly bow before thy throne of grace and mercy to say thank you. Thank you for the opportunity and the privilege of preaching the good news of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the Greater Second Baptist Church family and all of the churches that is still worshiping and praising you virtually in the name of Jesus. We ask now that our time together today by way of YouTube will be one whereby your spirit will lead, guide, and direct us. Open our hearts now that we might hear a word from your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let me share with you what's been on my heart the last 3 or 4 weeks in by way of Bible study. As you know, I've brought you a couple messages from the book of 1 Samuel. And I've been reading from chapter 13 all the way to the end of 1 Samuel. And it's about the life of King Saul and David. And I wanted to come today and just share with you another thought that I've got and encourage the church and those that's viewing. Spend some time this coming week in reading those chapters from about chapter 13 all the way to the end of the life of David and Saul, or read Goliath again and read the chapters after chapter 17. So today I want to bring you a message from 1 Samuel using scriptures, chapter 18, verses 1 through 9. Let me read those verses from the New King James Version. Now, when he had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul. Saul took him that day and would not let him go home to his father's house anymore. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan took off the robe that was on him and gave it to David with his armor, even to his sword and his bow and his belt. David went out wherever Saul sent him and behaved wisely. And Saul set him over the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all the people and also in the sight of Saul's servant. Now it had happened as they were coming home when David was returning from the slaughter of the Philistine that the women had come out of all the cities of Israel, singing and dancing to meet King Saul, with tambourines, with joy, and with musical instruments. So the women sang as they danced and said, "Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000. Then Saul was very angry and the saying displeased him. And he said, "They have ascribed to David 10,000 and to me they have ascribed only thousands. Now what more can he have but the kingdom?" So Saul eyed David from that day forward. I want to talk about the love of one and the jealousy of another. The love of one and the jealousy of another. You remember the ending of chapter 17 when David went out and slew the giant Goliath. And after David had slain Goliath, Saul sent one of his men out and asked, "Whose son is that?" And the man didn't know, but he went out. Abner was his name. He went out and inquired whose son this young man is. And the word got back that his name is David. And David came and spent time then with Saul. He said, "I'm Jesse's son. I'm the Benjamite. I'm Jesse's son. I am the son of your servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite." And so now we get to chapter 18, and we begin a good story. I mean, it's just a good story. So I don't come today with a whole lot of outline. I just want to recap the story and get our focus on this thought. There is a great love story, but I wanted to contrast it also with the jealousy of another. The love story begins in verse 1, and it says, "Now when he had finished speaking to Saul," that's David after killing Goliath, he's now talking to Saul. But there's something else in the B part. "The soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as his own soul." That's the way verse 1 reads. Let me read it out of the New International Version. David, that's 2 Samuel. Let me get over to 1 Samuel, chapter 18. "After David had finished talking with Saul, Jonathan became one in spirit with David, and he loved him as himself." Here we bring into the picture now a relationship between Saul's son, Jonathan, and David. And it appears that Jonathan is the one that encounters or begins the relationship. It is a relationship where the two men has bonded, and the Bible used that they were knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved David. The soul of Jonathan and the soul of David was knit together. That means on the inside, they became one in spirit. That's the thought that got my attention. As we look at all that's going on, as we look at a divided country now, as we look at everything now that we're living and we're facing as a country, our country is divided. And I wanted to come today and share with us, if we are going to do anything that's going to help a divided country, then it's going to have to start with loving one another. It's going to have to start with us understanding that love will join folks, but division will separate folks. So we see now this relationship that Jonathan has with David, and we look as the relationship began to develop. I want you to look and see verse 3. "Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul." Do you have any friends like that? Do you have any relationships like that? That's just a unique relationship, a covenant relationship. Now, these are not kinfolks. This is King Saul's son, and this is David, Jesse's son. And now that David has killed Goliath, Jonathan recognized something about David. Jonathan recognized that God is with David. Jonathan recognized that David has been empowered by the Lord. And as a result of that, the two spirits come together and they are as one. Now look what Jonathan done in verse 3 in this covenant relationship. Now, well, let me just share with you about a covenant. A covenant is different from a contract. A contract is two people get together and make an agreement. A covenant always brings God into the agreement. So now the covenant comes between the two, but they are doing it under the direction of the Holy Spirit. It said, then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. That's the second time. That saying is going to go on through chapter 18, 19, and even in chapter 20. And Jonathan now, here's the relationship beginning. And Jonathan took off the robe that was on him. Jonathan now, as him and David makes this covenant, Jonathan now takes off the robe that belongs to the king's son. Jonathan takes off the robe of royalty, and then he gives that to David. Not only do he take off the robe, he take off the tunic or the undergarment under the robe, the big shirt. Some tunics reached all the way down to the legs. He takes that off and gives that to David. Then he even takes his sword, his battle weapon, and he gives that to David, and he gives his bow and his belt. What Jonathan does now to in this covenant relationship is Jonathan gives David that which belonged to him as a son, and what he's saying to David is, now we are brothers, and I invite you into our family, and you can wear the royal robe, you can wear the tunic, you can take my sword, and you now are part of my, you are like my brother. That's what we are, church. We that are brothers and sisters have been made that way because we have the same spiritual father. We are brothers and sisters because our faith is in the Lord Jesus Christ. And as we go through this life now, we cannot afford to become divided. We've got to stay unified. We've got to stay in this love relationship. We've got to make sure now that there is nothing out there that's going to divide us. Coronavirus, COVID-19 will not divide us. No legislation will divide us as a church. Nothing, we're not going to let anything come against us and cause us to become divided. And David and Jonathan begin their walk together as one. But something happened. Other folks begin to praise. And there are those in the vicinity now, the women of the city, after the killing of Goliath, they get together in the streets and they start singing and dancing. But here is the great lyrics of the song. Saul has slain his thousands and David his 10,000. That's what they're singing. The women are singing and dancing in the streets and talking about how David has slain 10,000s and Saul has slain thousands. Verse 8 is a key verse. Then Saul was very angry, and the saying displeased him. And he said, they have ascribed to David 10,000, and to me they have ascribed only thousands. Now, what more can he have but the kingdom? So Saul's eyes were jealous from that time on. Verse 9 in the New International said, and from that time on, Saul kept a jealous eye on David. We see the love of Jonathan. We see how Jonathan loved David. But I wanted to bring the contrast in, because here is now the father of Jonathan, King Saul. And King Saul, as a result of someone else receiving accolades, as a result of somebody else getting a pat on the back, as a result of somebody else who have done a good job, get recognized by other people, and that caused him as king to become jealous. Jealous of David. Now, his jealousy led him to anger. Beware of a jealous spirit. That spirit is not of the Lord. And that spirit is one that cannot be kept because of two or three people in the same family. Let me share with you what I mean. If the father is wrong, Saul is wrong, Saul becomes jealous of David and starts strategizing on how to kill David. We're going to talk a little bit about that in chapter 19. But in the process of that, Jonathan did not agree with that. Here he is now, he loves David, and his daddy despises David. So now we got a family that is different in their treatment of David. Here's the point I want to make. Even if we are blood relatives and one of us is wrong, let's not all agree with the wrong person. Let's stand up and say, mama or dad, I think you're wrong. Do it respectfully. Brother, I think you're wrong. This is not right. This is not the way the Lord would have it. Let's not go along just to get along. I think in church we have to watch that. I think in church many times there are church splits. There are church disagreements. And sometimes because we are of the same family, we go along to get along. But wrong is wrong. I don't care if it's me. We cannot afford to collaborate with wrong, even if it's our own family. So that takes me to the study now. We got the women giving David accolades, and Saul gets an attitude. He gets angry. And now Saul comes up with a plan. Well, it was part of the agreement that whoever kills Goliath would get one of his daughters. So he offers David now his daughter, Michal. And David ends up, to make a long story short, David ends up marrying her. And now he is Saul's son-in-law. Now that ought to please David, and it kind of did, but Saul had it as a trap. He now want to use his daughter as a means of getting David killed. And he comes up with a plot. Now, verse 19, chapter 19 says, verse 1, now Saul spoke to Jonathan, his son, and to all his servants that they should kill David. But Jonathan, Saul's son, delighted greatly in David. So Jonathan told David, saying, my father Saul seeks to kill you. That's got to be hurting. That scared first got to hurt Jonathan. Jonathan, knowing now that his father want to kill David. And David, who has been faithful to Saul, who has played music to soothe Saul's anger. And now, from this point on, David is on the run for his life. Keep in mind, David has been anointed king, but he has not been made king yet. Saul is still king, but the Lord has anointed David. So chapter 19, Saul seeks to kill David, and he puts the plot out. Let me read a little bit more. Like I said, I just wanted to give you these chapters. Therefore, please be on your guard until morning and stay in a secret place and hide. And I will go out and stand beside my father in the field where you are, and I will speak with my father about you. Then what I observe, I will tell you. So Jonathan now realized that his daddy is trying to kill David. And Jonathan says, I'm going to go out and stand with my daddy, and we're going to talk about you. And whatever I find out, I'm going to bring back and let you know. And so that is how we are entered into now and seeing what Jonathan's plan is. But then Saul gets mad at Jonathan. Let me read verse 8 and 9. And there was war again, and David went out and fought with the Philistines and struck them with a mighty blow, and they fled from him. Now the distressing spirit from the Lord came upon Saul as he sat in his house with his spear in his hand, and David was playing music by his hand. Then Saul sought to pin David to the wall with the spear, but he slipped away from Saul's presence, and he drove the spear into the wall. So David fled and escaped that night. I mean, David now escapes for his life, and he is on the run, and he goes into the fields and hide, and Jonathan comes, and David tells Jonathan what Saul just done, how Saul just tried to kill him with the sword, and Jonathan could not really believe it. He couldn't believe it. What I wanted to share with you now is if you don't get control of jealousy, it can lead to anger. And anger can lead to you wanting to kill someone. You know, it is amazing how in our country, how many people now is coming up murdered, how they're finding people dead, and they have not committed suicide. Someone has gone in and killed another human being, and usually what causes that, it stems from jealousy, stems from anger and resentment and malice, and it turns into murder. And so we get to chapter 20, and I'm going to head toward the closing of this. But after Jonathan hears what David tells him about his father trying to kill him, but Jonathan can't really believe it. Jonathan tells David that his father don't do anything without confiding in me. You say he's trying to kill you? Well, let me tell you, if he's doing that, he will tell me about it. And he don't keep anything from me. And I just can't believe my daddy would do that to you. And David said, well, your daddy knows how you feel about me. Your daddy knows how I found favor with you. And he knows that if he tell you about his plot to kill me, how that would cause you harm and grief. And so he's going to keep that from you. And so David and Jonathan has this agreement about what's going to happen if his daddy agreed to try to kill him. And David go out in the field, and Jonathan tell him, well, tomorrow, day after tomorrow, the new moon, the festival, I'm going to have a boy with me, and he's going to shoot an arrow, And if the arrow goes beyond a certain point, I tell him the arrow went beyond, that means that my daddy is going to come after you. And if I tell him it falls short of a certain area, that means it's all right for you to come home. And so he finds out that Saul really is going to try to kill him. And that is a major concern of Jonathan and David. And because Jonathan tells his father that David wanted to go to Bethlehem, go back to his home, and have a festival and a sacrifice, and Saul don't like that because David's chair is empty at the table, and that's the reason Jonathan gives his daddy that David is not there. And his daddy don't like that, so now his daddy try to kill Jonathan. And so that brings us to the close of that little three chapter. And the point I want to make, all of that I've said was to get this little point across, is there is some folks that love folks. And there is some folks that's jealous of folks. There's some folks that hate folks. And the church has got to make sure that we are not a part of the hate group. We've got to make sure that we are not a part of the jealousy group. We've got to make sure that we are not a part of the division that's going on in our country. We've got to make sure that we as believers in Christ will stay together, will stay united, will always come against division. And whenever we see division, we're going to try to get rid of it. So during this, the rest of this year, election coming up, we are living in a time when we as the church has got to become united and decide that we're going to go to the polls and we're going to vote. We're not going to be about division. We're going to be about unity. And we're going to do all we can to gather ourselves together at the polls and do what we believe is right. Well, let me close. There was another love relationship. There was another covenant relationship. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life." God made a covenant relationship with mankind. And God said, whosoever will accept my son, whosoever by faith will call upon my name, I give my son to you as a sacrifice for your sins. And if you will accept this free gift, you can have everlasting life. John 3:16 is something that will never come out of our minds, that God loved us so much that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. The new covenant, the new testament, the new covenant is about a relationship between God and man, and God reaching out to man and drawing man back to himself through his only begotten son, Jesus Christ. If you have never accepted that kind of love, that love that will draw you, you need Jesus Christ. You need him to come into your heart and save your soul. We want to say to you today, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. First of all, if you have never accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, this first Sunday in July would be a great time, would be a good time, would be the best time to make him your Lord and Savior. And you can do it today. You can do it today by putting your faith in Jesus Christ. God loved us and he gave his son. His son died on Calvary. You got to believe that. You got to believe that the death of Jesus Christ is what God accepted as payment for our sin. You've got to believe that he died and he buried, and on the third day morning he got up with all power in heaven and earth in his hand. And you've got to ask him to come into your heart and save your soul. You've got to believe that with all your heart, and you've got to accept that as the payment for your sins, and you invite him to come into your heart. And he said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And if you do that, you've done that, you can tell him these words: Lord, thank you for saving my life. I believe in Jesus Christ. I accept him as the Lord and Savior of my life. And I want to live for him now. And Lord, help me live my life for him. And if you will do that, God will come into your life by way of the Holy Spirit, and he would forever live inside of you. Each first Sunday, we commune. And this first Sunday in July, we come with keeping the ordinance that the Lord gave to the church. One of the ordinances he gave was communion. We call it the Lord's Supper. And he said, I will not do this again with you until I do it anew in my Father's kingdom. But as often as you do it in remembrance of me. Let us commune together. Let me also wish a happy birthday to all of those who are born in the month of July. We want to say to you, we pray God's blessings upon you this month as you approach your birthday in the month of July. Be thankful, be grateful, remain humble, stay safe, and give the Lord praise and thanksgiving for all he has done for you, giving you another year. Let us say, like we say each first Sunday, you know I don't sing, but let me say it like this: happy birthday to you and many, many more. God bless you this day and always.